Okay, let's start by looking at the cost of equity. I have 18 slides. It looks like a lot. Trust me, there won't be anything new on the next 18 slides. It's really a review. About a third of this chapter is a review. But everything that comes together in this chapter comes from, let's see how many chapters, 8, 7, and 13, from three different chapters from before. So it's worth reviewing everything and kind of putting things in its place. So cost of equity. So that's basically the link between the firm that raises money from those type of investors who buy the firm's equity or common stock, in other words. These are two terms used interchangeably. And there are other investors who buy stock shares, but they're buying what we call preferred stock shares. So that's going to be on later slides. So let's focus on equity or common stock, or more precisely, cost of equity from the firm's perspective. From chapter 2, equity means if the firm were to sell all of its assets and use the sale proceeds to pay off all of its debts, liabilities, then equity would be the residual that would remain, and that would belong to the owners of the firm or the shareholders. Equity is also part of firm value that's traded in the market in the form of stock shares. Equity is also the bottom right of a balance sheet. So what is cost of equity? It's the return required by equity investors given the risk of the cash flows from the firm. We actually had two formulas already, two different approaches that were calculating the cost of equity, except we were never calling it cost of equity. We were calling it the return to stockholders, for example, or the required return. The first approach is from chapter 8, the so-called dividend growth model approach, which looked at how the price per share of stock is calculated when the dividends in the future are assumed to be growing indefinitely at a very specific and constant growth rate every year. The second approach, we're going to call it the SML, which from chapter 13 stands for the security market line approach. Or alternatively, we can call it the CAPM, capital asset pricing model approach. So that was all in chapter 13. Let's start with approach number one, the dividend growth model approach.